Good afternoon, everyone. So as Dimitri said, my name is Michael Reh. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Tymlez. Tymlez is incorporated in April 2016, and our headquarters is in the Netherlands. But as you can hear from my accent, I'm German, so I'm living in Heidelberg. So the Tymlez mission is basically to bring the blockchain to the enterprise. So the question is, what the hell does that mean? And quite recently, Gartner has published a research note where they were analyzing the blockchain space. And when you see the blockchain space, then you have the core blockchain technology. This is where Hyperledger, this is where BigChain, this is where Ethereum is playing. And on top of that, you have an additional layer, which is the so-called blockchain solution platform. And this is basically where we are playing. So we take care of the identity management. We take care about the runtime environment when you have operational and non-operational applications running. This is where your DApps are running. This is where you do the entire integration into existing system landscapes, which you might have in an enterprise already. And just think about the fact that companies have invested billions of dollars already into existing landscapes. And somehow you need to bridge the gap between the slow-moving backends and the fast-moving frontends. And this is what that space is all doing. So as Dimitri said, we are one of the early adopters. So I basically met Bruce in March 2016, first time, during the announcement. And I said, that's exactly, this is what I need. This will help me to bring blockchain to the enterprise, because also performance is key. You know, there are a lot of data in the blockchain, and you need to query that data, and more importantly, you need to integrate that into existing business processes, into your Microsoft system, your SAP system, into your Dynamics system. Yeah, and this is what that technology basically allows you to do. So in the meantime, we have built numerous applications, and I will share with you today four of the use cases which we have built. Most of them have passed the pilot phase already. Some of them are in the process of getting legal blessing right now, especially in the Netherlands, and we will talk about that in a second. So the first use case is a company called CIB. CIB is basically getting disrupted as we speak by technology. So have you heard about the term secured papers? Yeah, so a secured paper is a piece of paper which is in your Visa. It has certain security features. Yeah, so it's something which exists in atoms. And everything which is an atom these days can be disrupted by technology, because you can start reproducing them and morph them into zeros and ones. And this is what's happening in the industry. So a lot of fraud is basically happening. So for them, this is all about getting more secure. The secure paper was already being secure, but now you have photocopiers and you have laser printers, and it becomes very easy for every one of us to just reproduce those kind of papers. So a lot of fraud is happening in that industry as we speak. So what you see on the left-hand side is basically an example of such a secure paper, and there were a couple of security features being built in there. So you can see this one is a copy, so you see the copy watermark over there. Yeah, there is micro-printing, these little dots are full sentences, but in the meantime, you can reproduce that. So that paper for the Dutch government is being used for the visa process, and those documents are being used in the supply chain management process. So every export from the Netherlands to the islands of Aruba, Bonaire, and Curaçao is being printed on those papers. The entire documentation towards those countries is being done on those papers. And you can imagine a lot of fraud is now happening in those countries. So what we are doing is basically that we use something which is called the proof of existence. So we are incorporated into the system landscape. Yeah, we have built a printer driver, so when those kind of documents are being printed, then we start attaching a QR code. That QR code helps us later on in the process to identify the original document. The document gets hashed, the document gets uploaded to the blockchain, and finally, the papers are being handed out to the immigrants. When the immigrant is now getting to border control, they show their paper. Border police is scanning the QR code, and the original document is being retrieved again from the blockchain, and they can start comparing that. And the same is happening in the harbor. When the ship is arriving, when the bill of lading is coming, all of those kind of documents are being compared as well. So meaning zero fraud happening at all. And these are just two examples, where the paper is being used, and any kind of communication between the Netherlands and of Ireland is happening on those kind of papers. The next one is very similar. There's a company called Grant Thornton in the UK. So Grant Thornton is known as being one of the leading auditing companies, and their business problem is really, how do I share confidentially information with my clients? And you can imagine there's a regulatory framework around that. So if there is an audit, let's assume this is your year-end process, then you get a certificate. And on that certificate, there are basically two sections, I like and I wish. And the I wish part is potentially relevant for the SEC. So they need to make sure that that information is only in the right hands and only the right people can see that. Yeah, and this is where we're using the blockchain capabilities again in order to improve the track and traceability of information, and we have put smart contracts around that which are govern the access finally to data. And these are just a few screenshots how that application looks like. Yeah, so if you want to share information with a client, it could be any kind of digital asset up to 4 GB, and you can share that with a browser. Yeah, then you start uploading that document. Yeah, then the documents are getting sharded. We do encryption. Everything gets uploaded, and then finally, you get an email, and then you can start downloading the original document. What that allows you now is that all the individual steps, I've sent you an email, the email is there, the email has been downloaded, the email has been decrypted, all of that is being tracked in the blockchain, and the regulators have access to that as well. Yeah? And there was a question earlier on, how do you deal with the regulators? Involve them very early, and then they are happy. Yeah, that is our experience so far. The next use case is in the area of supply chain management. And this is what we do with the Ministry of Transportation in the Netherlands to track and trace dangerous goods. Yeah, so dangerous goods in the Netherlands right now, there is a chemical company and you have an explosive good. Yeah, as soon as you want to do a transport, if you want to create a bill of lading, you need to get approvals. As of today, that's in back office process. A couple of hundred people are involved in the entire process to manage that end to end. Yeah, this gets now fully automated by smart contracts. Yeah, and what that basically means is that you take a certificate, you start attaching that certificate to the blockchain. Yeah, that certificate then is being used in a smart contract, which is a validator contract, to validate whether you're allowed to transport stuff on the road. That is being forwarded finally to the transportation company. That is an event, it's being tracked, it's in the blockchain. Regulators are happy. If you now go to the border, they have access to the information. So entirely, this creates transparency, which they never had before. And this is basically the way how we model smart contracts. And there was a question earlier about usability. Me personally, I'm not a big fan of coding and low-level coding languages, while we do all that stuff, obviously, in low-level. Yeah, but at the end of the day, we have seen what's happening. It is complex, and we need to remove that complexity. My vision is to bring simplicity, basically, to end users. Yeah? And I believe that at the end of the day, in the enterprise, it should be the end user who's sitting together with IT modeling smart contracts. Yeah, so this is our design time environment. Yeah, in order to model the entire supply chain, which you have just seen from the source of the dangerous good, the transportation company, the receiver, as well as the waste company, is being modeled, and there were just 10 lines of native code being used for that. So this is what I see as the next generation of modeling tools to help us really to bring blockchain kind of applications to the enterprise. Finally, and this project excites me most because I believe this will really have an impact to the world. This is where we increase children's life. Yeah, so we started that project a month ago. Yeah, and this is really about crisis management. And crisis management is all about identity management. So you as a volunteer, if you do a social sabbatical, you can apply, you can volunteer your work to save the children. And then internally there's a process, obviously, where they need to do a lot of background check about you. They are checking your health record. Yeah, partially they are checking all your data with Interpol. Yeah, because at the end of the day, they need to guarantee when you have been selected as a volunteer and you have been sent on site that you are the one who you're saying you are and that you have the qualities you have, you're saying you have. So you can say, yes, we have done that already before, but from an architecture point, what is interesting here is that we are changing the way how data are being controlled. So today, if you're working in enterprise and this kind of application is being built, then the data are under control of the enterprise. And you upload your CV and you have no clue what's happening to your CV. You're uploading your health record and you have no idea what's happening to your health record data. And then suddenly they are in Excel sheet and they're being forwarded by emails and they're here and they are there and everyone knows everything about you, right? This is where we are changing the architecture completely. So the entire data are full under control of the volunteer, and it's basically the volunteer who determines who in the enterprise has access to the data. And all of that is being governed by a smart contract. And what all of these projects have in common is they are all working at the edges, yeah, of their existing system landscapes. You need to start integrating those processes, those smart contracts, with the back-end systems which do exist. You can't afford as an enterprise to start replicating all your data. You need to think about identity management. Maybe there's an LDAP server, maybe there's an Active Directory server. How do you start integrating that? What about your PKI? Reporting capabilities. And that makes the enterprise business completely different versus the public blockchains here, yeah, which we see. And most of that, what we do today, all projects are starting with a private blockchain. They all have bigger pictures of that, what they would like to achieve. And then over time, they move to consortiums and adding additional federation nodes in order to bring additional business partners in. So in order to sum that up, I think this is how we all started. Every one of us got very excited about the blockchain. We got some blockchain code and we've done something. But then what do we need to do in order to productize that and really add value to the business? And then you figure out there were a few bits and pieces which are missing. And this is what Gartner basically calls the blockchain solution platform. And that is the integration layer basically between the new world and the old world. In terms of lessons learned, what is interesting is that still very often we are getting these funny questions. Yeah? So if I start applying the blockchain, do I have to go to jail? No, of course not. But there's this association between there's Bitcoin, yeah, and Bitcoin is blockchain. Yeah, that's just the technology which underpins Bitcoin. That's it. Yeah, but you can use that if you want to do that. And in most of these projects, the regulators are being involved from the very beginning, which is also a very important lessons learned for us. But what is more important is that the project after the POC phase, and we always see this POC phase, then we have the pilot phase, and then we have the go live phase, yeah, involve everyone, and everyone means the boss. Because a big misperception between what the bosses think what blockchain is and what smart contracts are, and how much money they can save, yeah, versus what the developer thinks they can do with that technology. And I think we need to bridge that gap ASAP in order to bring finally the blockchain to the enterprise. So that said, I want to thank you very much. And if there were any kind of technical questions, let me know.
Thank you, Michael. I think we have time for one question of the audience. Even two, says Masha. All right. I see there.
Hello. Ah, when you're talking about the blockchain, what language are your smart contracts written in, and what kind of blockchain are you using?
So we use a kind of a markup language on the one hand side, and the markup language is being enriched by JavaScript. Yeah, and that is being compiled and hashed into the blockchain powered by BigChain.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
I think we have another question here.
Hi, I would have a question regarding to the data integration you mentioned. When you talk about those projects, I'm here if you're looking for How big is the estimate of the data integration from legacy systems for those projects, and how did you solve that actually? Did you use some kind of metadata systems, or what are you basically doing to tackle this issue?
A good question. So overall, if you see the duration of the project, 95% of making it working and making it working in the context of the enterprise, 95% of that work has nothing to do with blockchain at all. Now, this is what we have experienced. So that's just the small little piece. Yeah? So now, it really depends. I mean, my background is I was an EVP at SAP, so I know SAP obviously in and out. Yeah, so for me, integrating with an SAP system, that is pretty easy. Yeah, there were other systems I'm not so familiar with. They don't have sophisticated technology and API infrastructures. Sometimes they are legacy systems. So if they are legacy systems, very often, especially when you talk about FS, yeah, they still run an AS400 with COBOL code. Yeah, and there's even a web service available. So that makes it very hard. If you get to more, call it more modern environments, let's take JD Edwards, where you have an eventing system, then you can start communicating via messaging or other means. So it really depends on what your backend is exposing. But we normally work in a RESTful manner, and we expose and we try to consume JSON objects.
Okay, let's hear it for Michael Ray one more time.
Thank you. Thank you.